Dairy is a huge part of New Zealand. It contributes massively to our economy, making up 25% of our exports. Agriculture's always been the backbone of the country, but the perception of dairy is changing.
Farming has created scars in the soil, and we're now seeing the downsides of it, and we're at crossroads. The dairy industry is at crossroads.
Dairy cows are one of the most polluting animals you can farm, and we've filled our country with them. The massive growth of dairy over the last 30 years has come with negative impacts on our environment. Excessive fertilisers on our paddocks, pollution of our rivers, and high emissions contributing to climate change.
We're living on a hope and a prayer here. We have to try to control what we can control, and we're also seeing our land as being degraded.
In this series, I investigate environmental issues down on the farm and seek solutions. Farmers are part of who we are as Kiwis, and so is the love of the environment we live in. These are big issues for all of us here in Aotearoa, in the land of milk and money. Nearly all our food production is only possible because of this, the whenua, the land and soil of Aotearoa. Dairy's very focused on the short-term goal of growing as much grass as possible. The more grass you can grow, the more cows you can have. But what about the long term? I mean, we've only been dairying at this scale for the past 30 years, and we're already starting to see some cracks form in the health of our soil. Erosion, high nutrients, heavy compaction. Well, too many cows now mean less food in the future. But to understand the future of our soils, first we need to look back. I mean, growing up surrounded by these rolling grassy hills, it can be easy to lose sight of just how new and foreign this kind of landscape is for Aotearoa. 3,000 years ago, Aotearoa was a dense forest from coast to coast. Māori arrived in the 13th century and cleared paths for exploration and food cultivation. Then in the 19th century, European colonisers arrived and began to adapt the land, introducing animals of all kinds, sheep, cows, deer and stoats. The most money to be made in New Zealand was from agriculture, and so colonists began seizing the best land and seeding exotic grasses far and wide. A process that the land of Aotearoa is still recovering from, as the tangata whenua. Murray Hemi is the sustainability manager for Māori-owned dairy business Miraka, a company whose story encapsulates what's happened to Aotearoa's land in the past 200 years.
In order for the European or the settler economy to thrive, the Māori economy actually needed to die. It needed to be broken. If you have the land, then you get to make the gold. And if you have the gold, then you get to make the rules. So if I think about that in terms of my own historical context, I think about Lake Wairarapa. When Europeans first started to arrive, Māori didn't sell their land. What they were prepared to do was lease it. But that wasn't really the plan of New Zealand settlement. The Crown needed to buy land really, really cheaply, sell it at a marked up price. That was then going to fund the establishment of government. What the Crown did is legislate for that leasehold arrangements to be illegal, and therefore the only new stream of revenue and income for Māori was selling their land. So ultimately in 1896, the decision amongst the chiefs is let's gift the lake to the Crown and rely on their largesse and their mana to give us an equivalent gift back. In 1916, that's 20 years later, finally the Crown gazette and provide an area of land in the centre of the North Island, which is basically unusable, undevelopable, and inaccessible to us. We didn't shift up there until 1948. We start to break in the land and develop it. And over time, we start to build that asset up into what it is now as a significant participant in the dairy industry.
Colonisers dramatically transformed Aotearoa in the creation of agricultural land. In just 200 years, almost all of our wetlands were drained, native forests reduced to around 30%, and our most dominant land cover became exotic grass, now 40% of all land area. It shouldn't be surprising that this kind of dramatic land transitions had repercussions, issues the dairy industries both inherited and made worse. Take, for instance, erosion. When heavy cows are kept close together, they turn soil to mud, and then when it rains, that soil runs off into our rivers and oceans. It's estimated that we lose 84 million tonnes of soil a year to our rivers from our farmland. New Zealand makes up less than 0.1% of all the land mass in the world, but were responsible for nearly 2% of the world's soil being eroded into the ocean. Wetlands in New Zealand once would have captured much of the soil before it reached the ocean. Not only are those wetlands gone, but they're now the paddocks causing the erosion. Mahuru Wilcox is a researcher from Manaaki Whenua, Landcare Research. Her focus has been on understanding the benefits of wetlands, benefits that we've lost.
There's been a long history of people dissing swamps. That historic mentality around that's a swamp, it's a waste of space, you know, my cows get stuck in it, I need to get rid of it. I guess the easiest way to explain that is look what's happening with our wetlands, and you can see the effects on our rivers and streams from that. You have algal blooms, you have problems with sedimentation, loss of species. A wetland is really an environment between water and land. They act as a buffer. So if you didn't have a wetland and you just had a river or stream, the banks would erode away. At the same time, anything that you put onto the land, they act as a filter or kidneys to take it out of the water before it gets to our rivers and streams and then eventually oceans. They could help mitigate the loss of soil, erosion, also the impacts of putting fertilisers and things onto the land, but they can only do so much. So you really need to address those issues as well. You can't just rely on wetlands to be the one silver bullet. When that removal happened, people didn't really know better. And so what we're trying to do now is undo that damage and restore these habitats, which is a lot more effort than it is to just not remove them in the first place. I think now we know better, and so the information is out there to do better.
The pressure to our land is a combination of what we've lost and what we've replaced it with. Many of New Zealand's biggest dairy impacts have come from dairy expanding into areas previously thought unsuitable. Angus Robson is an engineer and environmentalist who's been campaigning across the South Island, highlighting the impacts of dairying on unsuitable soil types.
For dairying, it doesn't seem to matter what soils we have, we try and dairy on them. The soil types where dairy's traditionally been practiced are deeper soils on flatter land. They're normally well-drained. A lot of them are ex-swamps, and that's where you get the deep soils. But then dairy's moved on to inappropriate areas. Because of cheap land and the ability to punch the fertiliser into it, like Canterbury, which is very stony and causes a lot of side effects of nitrate, like Southland, where it's very wet during the winter, like every water quality problem is really a land use problem. So if you trace why some water's bad, look to the land upstream of it, and there's your problem. And so I thought, well, I can't fix it by dealing with the water. You can't filter it out or anything. You have to go and solve it at source, which is land use. Well, Southland's a good example of that. Intensive winter grazing in Southland is characterised by having a lot of cows in a small area for a long time. When you do that, you churn the fields to mud. And then it rains, and it always rains. That soil gets mobilised, it's full of phosphorus, it's quite highly loaded with germs. Those germs go into a ditch or a small stream, which dump all the sediment out in the estuary. There was so much pressure to do high intensity dairying in Canterbury. It was a colossal mistake. There's very little soil in big areas of Canterbury. It's very thin and it doesn't grow enough grass to feed a herd of cows unless you water it and you put a lot of fertiliser on it.
There's a shift happening from thinking about where it's possible to dairy to where it's suitable to dairy. Analysis by Ag Research shows that there are places in the country where cows would need to be removed to meet water quality expectations. This could affect as much as 10% of land currently being farmed, particularly in Southland and Canterbury.
There are so many solutions to this, but many of them involve a big lifestyle change and a lot of pain. How are we going to cope with that? That's the conversation to be had.
At the heart of this conversation is soil, and I don't just mean about land use or dairy, but life itself. 95% of food on the planet is only possible because of a vastly complex ecosystem of life beneath our feet. Making that soil is a millennia-long process. Over time, rocks are broken down to their base minerals. These bind together, creating electrical charges that allow them to absorb nutrients fundamental to life and then release them to feed growing plants. Through the life cycle of flora and fauna, the soil becomes rich and diverse with bacteria, fungi, insects, and plants that harness and cycle the nutrients necessary for plant growth. Intensive dairy can disrupt this system with heavy cows that squash the dirt together, leaving less room for life, and fertilizers introducing more nutrients than the soils can actually absorb. Frank van Steensel is an agroecologist working with farmers to reduce the number of inputs they need on farm. He moved from the Netherlands to New Zealand 30 years ago to escape the soil damage industrialized farming was causing, only to find the problem chased him here too.
Growing up and being educated in the Netherlands, we could see and experience the downsides of how society treated soils and how society treated farmers and how society treated the environment. When you grow up seeing the disadvantages of industrialized farming and the impact on the environment, it felt like we were fleeing. We were the first ecological refugees. So this is when we left to New Zealand, some friends of ours. It's my dad.
And when we came here
to clean it in New Zealand, the first thing I realized, it is beautiful here. But learning more about New Zealand farming, going to the river started feeling the same as going to the river in the Netherlands, because in our time, we couldn't swim in the river. We were running from intensive farming to end up in a country which was intensifying farming. Soil's underestimated, mate. In a teaspoon of soil, there are as many microbes than there are mammals on the planet. There are communities of microbes working together, recycling the energy, the information, and the matter. And because energy keeps on booming in because of the sun, soil is the skin of the planet, the skin of the earth. When you're a gardener, all you do is tear up the skin of the earth over and over again. What does it do? It grows back green matter to cover up that wound. It's like if I scratch myself, your skin heals and becomes a mature tissue again, like the tissue that was there before. By taking the green matter away over and over again, you're constantly creating a scab. After a while, you get scar tissue. Now, the consequence of that is you've lost already some soil functions because you've lost some microbes in the community. Bringing in the bag of fertilizers that make nitrogen available to the plants, phosphorus available to the plants, the microbes, they're no longer needed. They're unemployed. They leave, they migrate to another area. Now you've kickstarted the downward spiral.
Frank is part of a growing group of farmers in New Zealand who want to achieve productive soil through its natural cycles, rather than artificial inputs. Often called the regenerative movement, the basic idea is to have more plant diversity on pasture, allow soils to develop longer, and use less fertilizer. They think this will allow dairy cows to exist as part of a larger self-sustaining ecological system, rather than the input-reliant one farms currently use. The hope is, a naturally balanced system will be less detrimental on the environment and animal health, and be cheaper to run.
How is this any different than the pastures that everyone sees every day?
On a high-intensive dairy farm, you tend to have only one type of grass rather than a multitude of grasses.
Right.
The whole paddock looks the same. This farmer's experience was that the soil was showing signs of tiredness.
Yeah.
In other words, the productivity was going down.
Mm-hmm.
So then he started asking questions. Now, besides having the focus on grass, there's also a focus on legumes,
mm-hmm.
and there's a focus on herbs. And after 3 or 4 years, he's admitting that it's been doing better mm-hmm. and that the cows are healthier.
So the way you see it's looking healthier on top is that it's got all of these different kinds of plants on it. And then what difference does that make underground?
That means there's all kinds of different microbial communities working between the soil and the plants as well.
Mm-hmm.
And every type of plant got a different microbial community, not just quantity, but also quality. This diverse pasture creates more organic matter, develops more soil than just grass or grass clover by itself. I think it's time for us, humankind, to grow up, to act mature. What's at stake is soil quality, air quality, water quality, quality of life. I've never lost sight of the potential that New Zealand as a country and an environment has to be paradise on earth.
The regenerative movement's been met with a lot of skepticism in New Zealand. I've actually encountered a lot of this misinformation and negativity myself. And I can kind of understand why the dairy industry wouldn't like it. I mean, the model would mean less money on fertilisers, less milk for processors. But in return for a small drop in production, regenerative supporters say that it could offer healthier animals and environment, a better lifestyle for farmers. 3 years ago, Sam Hogg and his family started transitioning their dairy farm to the regenerative model.
Welcome to the farm.
How many cows have you got in total?
We've got 300. More and more have stuck out, the better been fed, so that it's been this almost ripple effect of there becomes a friendly cow, all the other cows are so curious, they wonder what's this human interaction happening.
So as you develop your pastures, the personalities of the cows have come out more.
Definitely.
Why do you think that is?
The fact that things are minerally balanced, or much more minerally balanced, says a lot for it. It's like humans. If things are in balance, we're true to our form, we're much happier in ourselves, we're not wanting for so much more. This portion of land has been in the family since 1852. We got quite intense. Dad converted, ironically, for succession purposes, so that someone could just come in and run it and the family didn't have to be involved.
Yeah. What was the decision about what kind of farm you'd move into?
We got together and like, right, this isn't going so well. We're living on a hope and a prayer here. Have to try control what we can control. And we're also seeing our land as being degraded. There was such a meeting of the minds on it, and that we did all agree that this wasn't the right way and that there was a better way. We want to improve our land again. We haven't liked the last history. We have all this infrastructure already in place. We can't just throw it out. We have the debt, and we have to basically keep dairy farming. And how can we do it in a much better way? We didn't think initially that it would be so much more profitable.
It was very much led by Dad. Dad wanted to sit us all down and ask us what our vision was for the farm for the future, because he recognised that the decisions he was making now would affect us all, and whoever comes after us, you know. And so he was like, well, look, you know, what do you all see for this farm? Because let's start laying that groundwork now.
What's the difference between regenerative and organic?
I think the important thing is the foundation of the two is the same. It's about the improvement of the environment as a whole and a better approach to farming.
The cows are happier because they've got this robust pasture to eat off of. How does a healthier soil and more diverse pasture change that impact of the cows?
One thing that you see quite quickly is the decomposition of the urine and the feces. I mean, if you look down here, look at all those worm castings. That was once essentially a patch of poo, and you look what's happened, the worms have just gone crazy and decomposed that. That's a really good sign that the biology is working. The more diverse, the better it is at handling the ups and downs and the peaks and troughs. And so what we're trying to mimic is the foundation of where our soil came from, you know, the basic ecological functions. It can just improve and improve. It's like this really beautiful positive feedback loop where the stronger it gets and the better outcome for us as farmers. Regenerative right now, there is no premium. The idea is that, you know, you can lower your costs and the net profit will end up being greater. That transition, it was going to cost.
Right. Where do those costs come from?
I mean, mainly the production hit.
Because you're producing less milk, presumably.
Producing less milk, we can't have as many cows. And then also the cost of oversowing diversity across the farm. We're looking at the farm as a whole new business, and that this business isn't going to necessarily just make money from day dot. That transformation at the end of it will be a greater business, and it will be more financially stable and sustainable. We wanted to prove, you know, if we can do it with our debt levels, then why can't everyone else do it? It's possible to make these transitions, and
Just gotta be brave.
It may not seem it, but our soils are finite, and yet they produce almost all our food. We need them to continue to do so forever. We can't afford to be losing so much of it to the ocean, or be degrading it by farming in unsuitable areas, be pushing it so far with fertilizer. Whether it be regen or something else, we need to find a system that balances sustainability with production. In the next episode, we're going to look at milk itself, and whether technology might remove cows from the equation altogether.